This educational program is made possible by the support of our generous Patreon patrons. And as always, check out the description below for time codes and for all resources discussed in this episode. And now, let's start the show. Welcome one and all to another episode of Engage, where learning through play is the name of the game. I sincerely hope all of you watching are healthy and safe. Now for today's episode, I'm really excited because we're finally digging into one of the indisputable juggernauts in the digital game-based learning space, Minecraft. Now, as a teacher and an educational technology coach, I've been leveraging Minecraft for educational purposes for a long time, long before Microsoft bought Mojang Studios, and then 17 months later also purchased Joel Levin's Minecraft EDU to rebrand it as the Minecraft Education Edition that teachers around the world know and love today. And why do teachers who use Minecraft love it so much? Well, one big reason why is because Minecraft is the pinnacle of what you would call a sandbox game. And when you get to play in a sandbox, the possibilities are endless. You can dig and build, and in a sense, there are no rules. Heck, unlike many other games out there, there's not even necessarily any specific player objectives. The only goal in a sandbox game as a player is to maximize the freedom you are given in order to exercise your creativity. And who doesn't love that? Now, of course, there are going to be some limitations inherent in any video game, as a player can only make use of mechanics that the designer built into the experience. For example, in the original 8-bit series of Mega Man games, no matter how badly the player might want to, there is no button that you can press in order to pet your faithful companion Rush when you summon him to your side. In Minecraft, however, because the original designers of the game left the door open in order for players to tinker and mod the game's code, that feeling of freedom you get when playing in a sandbox extends into the design of the very game itself. And in that vein, earlier this year, I had the incredible opportunity to come together with a team of volunteers who sought to leverage that freedom that Minecraft makes possible in order to celebrate the legacy of a man who fought hard for freedom and justice for all. For many years, it has been the proud tradition of the nonprofit Volunteer Action Center LA Works to gather the community together on Martin Luther King Jr. Day for, as they put it, a day on, not a day off, to help those in need. But obviously this year, due to the pandemic, there are health and safety concerns with getting people together in person. So they needed to figure out a way to pivot in a different direction. And this is the story of what happened.
LA Works is LA's oldest and largest volunteer agency. We've been operating since 1991, but a lot of our growth has happened in the last 10 to 12 years, and we mobilize 25,000 volunteers every year.
What inspired you guys to create the whole unique interactive experience for Martin Luther King Day?
The first thing I thought of was Fortnite, because I'd just seen an artist showcase where this artist essentially did an art exhibit in Fortnite. And I was like, oh, that's cool. What if we just did that for MLK Day? I did some research. I found Mike Washburn's podcast on Fortnite education, and it was also talking about Minecraft education.
He reached out to me and said, for years we've done this really big Martin Luther King Day event. Obviously, we can't do it the same as we've done it in the past, which has been this big in-person festival. Do you have any ideas on how we might do this virtually? I said to him, I don't think Fortnite is your game for this, but I do think Minecraft is. One thing led to another. We started talking about his vision for the day to look like. And so I came up with the idea of building out basically Washington, D.C., almost like a recreation of the March on Washington.
He was super ambitious. He wanted to create a one-to-one scale replica of the Washington Mall. And I was just picturing the Lincoln Memorial and like, that's it. Which is why the world now is like huge. It's so big.
What design goals did you guys have in mind as you're crafting this experience together?
I wanted to make it feel like you were there. The interesting thing about it was that it was almost like this event that was out of time, because you had modern NPCs and you had these amazing civil rights leaders, many of whom are no longer with us.
We wanted people to know about the activists that were in the world. I think we met that goal with getting engaged and doing some of the research, or artists coming in and volunteering, skinning the Minecraft people.
The broad goal was to educate the people that were traveling through the world on activists, from the 1960s to today. So we did this in the form of creating NPCs and then writing dialogue so that people could travel throughout the world, come up to an NPC. John Lewis, who recently passed away, he was very young at the time, but he was right there, literally standing feet from Dr. Martin Luther King during the I Have a Dream speech. And a lot of people didn't even know that John Lewis was there. AOC was in the world, Oprah Winfrey, Ruth Bader Ginsburg was in the world, Michelle Obama. So you could go up to Trevor Noah in the world and he was wearing a nice suit and looked really cool, and you could click on him and then he would tell his story to you. He would explain who he is and why he's important and how he's relevant to this kind of experience. So we did that with almost 300 NPCs.
Wow.
We decided to go with the Citizens 2 plugin. Then there was an add-on with that. I think it was called Denizens, and it allowed us to have an NPC that was able to sit. And that made it so that we had some people who were in a wheelchair and they needed to be represented correctly.
Oh, that's really cool.
We knew that this would be some people's very first time playing Minecraft. Like, for me and Jossie before this project, we never played Minecraft. So we wanted the world to be robust while making like the exploration aspect as simple and easy to follow as possible. What happened to us was that we got lost because the map is so big. We wanted to showcase the buildings that the designers spent the most time on because that was where we placed the NPC activists. Even though we wanted people to explore as much as possible, we also wanted to draw attention to the level of detail and research that went into the project and make sure that people pay attention and remember those points.
Was there anything that surprised you guys along the way in collaborating and making the whole experience happen?
People could reflect on the world and they had like a little space to build, which we debated about putting in the experience. But I'm glad we did because some of the things that the volunteers came up with was just an amazing, amazing reflections. Some people created little MLKs. They did like an LGBT flag that like moved. And I was like, I didn't know you could do that in Minecraft.
I was also surprised by the monuments that people built at the end and the things that people came up with. We wanted the experience to inspire folks and just the level of creativity. I can't even put it into words. I wish that we could just recreate that experience, and we do hope to. And other projects in the future.
The world was only open for one day, so we got a lot of messages after the fact saying, you know, I missed it. Is there a way for me to come and take a look now? And frankly, there's not at the moment, but we would like there to be.
I would really love to be able to create multiple lessons using this world. It's full of museums, and many of those museums are representing people who've been marginalized throughout history in the United States.
We'd have to have someone always managing the world at all times to make sure things don't get destroyed or whatever. And because we're such a small team and have such a limited knowledge of Minecraft, we don't have the people power to really do that. But we're trying to figure it out. That's still a part of the plan too, is to have like a space or a time for people who want to check it out can come through and just enter the world.
Giving them a space to admire other people's work, especially like the build aspect, like when they go to the build area, they can look at what other people thought of, while at the same time making sure those monuments are protected, because we did have players throughout the day who tried to destroy what other people built. It took some technical know-how to try to restore them.
Do you guys have any further projects like this in mind for the future?
We've got a proposal going out. We're shopping around to a couple of different schools to convert the experience into education edition, so teachers can really manage their own server with the content in there. The reason why we're trying to make the shift from Java to education edition is because there's just more tools available to teachers that are more accessible than like, or setting up plugins in Minecraft. That's like it's definitely a whole world to set up like that type of security for classrooms and their students. It's just an easier experience on Education Edition. It's kind of just like made for that. So this definitely isn't the last that we're going to be using this world. And we might even do it again next year. You know, who knows?
So my friends, there you have it. I want to thank Jossie and Stephanie from LA Works and Becky and Mike from Participate for taking the time to share their insights into the process of crafting this unique interactive experience. And I certainly share their hopes that the Minecraft March on Washington, D.C. will become available in the near future for more people to be able to experience and make use of. And if and when that time comes when that is made possible, you'll definitely hear about it right here on Engage. In the meantime, I'm sure this is only just the beginning of digging into Minecraft here on this show, but there are still so many other games, not to mention other kinds of games, that we still have yet to explore. So stick around. Until next time, I've been Jeremy, and this has been Engage, where learning through play is the name of the game. Thanks for watching.